The hour of convening having arrived, all members of the House will please come to the floor and take seats. All members. Clerk will ring the bell. All members of the House will please come to the floor and take seats. All members, we're going to have the call of the roll here in a moment. Mr. Clerk, ring the bell one more time. I see the flow of traffic's going the wrong way. All members will please come to the floor and take seats. We're going to have the call of the roll. All members present will please vote green to signify their presence in the chamber, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. Doorkeepers will please close the doors and keep them closed. House will come to order. Well, good morning. This sheet in front of me says it's legislative day 39. We almost see the lights across the river here. We will have scripture reading and prayer by the chaplain, after which we will pledge allegiance to the flag. Our chaplain this morning will be introduced by the gentleman from the 15th House District, Representative Paul Battles. Representative Battles.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is an honor for me to introduce our chaplain of the day. Dr. Gerald Harris comes to us by way of the beginning in Hickory, North Carolina, where he was born. Attended high school there, then he migrated, did a great migration down to Georgia, where he was educated at Mercer University, and it just so happens that one of his classmates, or was in school with him, I think Gerald was maybe a year ahead of him, was Brooks Coleman. And so if you need to know anything about our speaker today, you can ask Brooks. But I think it would be good because there's two things. One, he was born in 1940, and on his bio it says, and I was born again in 1950. And he truly exhibits that as our interim pastor at First Baptist Church of Cartersville. He has been a man that has not disappointed anyone. He is a man who preaches the gospel without being ashamed or hesitant. He is a family man. He is married to Martha Jean. They have some wonderful children, a daughter and twin sons, and they also have seven grandchildren. I have something in common with them. I do not have a son, but I do have twin daughters, and we have seven grandchildren, so we do have something in common. As I said, he was educated at Mercer University, where he received his undergraduate, then the Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary in Wake Forest, where he received his graduate degree in theology, and then he graduated from Luther Rice Seminary in Jacksonville, Florida, with his doctorate of ministry. He is a wonderful speaker, and he has brought us in these times in between pastors to a level of realizing what it's all about, and that is serving God and being faithful to Him. And with that, he has demonstrated in a lot of different ways in his preaching, in his service to the community. He has brought devotions many times to our Atlanta Hawks. He has been a college chaplain of two different universities. And he now serves as the editor of the Georgia Baptist newspaper called the Christian Index. And it's wonderful for me to have him. The speaker said just a moment, said it's about over. And I thought about that would be a great time to give an invitation if we said it's about over and see how much movement we would have. But I'm not going to do that, but we're going to listen very attentively as Dr. Gerald Harris comes and shares out of the Word of God.
Thank you very much, Representative Battles, Mr. Speaker. It's a delight to be here today. I have had this experience before, but I really get nervous when I speak to this House, and evidence of that was this morning when I made a very serious mistake in preparing myself physically to come. Have you ever noticed that a tube of toothpaste is the same size as a tube of Preparation H? And if you get the wrong tube, you will quickly discover that it does not taste very good. The good thing about it, however, is that my gums have not itched all morning. I just hope my tongue doesn't disappear when I'm trying to speak to you. But I accept your sympathy and condolences with great respect and appreciation. In Luke chapter 12 and verse 48, the Bible says, "For unto whomsoever much is given of him shall be much required, and to whom men have committed much of him they will ask the more." First of all, I would like to say this morning that you are affirmed. You were elected to a very strategic political office. People have committed much to you. They have entrusted to you the affairs of this great state. Your constituents have affirmed you. You are their chosen elected officials in this House. Congratulations. Some of you no doubt will go further in your career as a public servant. Your political capital will rise. You will be affirmed more and more in the years ahead, for you have attained a measure of success, but you will experience even greater success, I'm sure. I heard a story about three business professionals who were comparing ideas of what it meant to be successful. One man said, "I think I would be successful if I were summoned to the White House for a private, personal meeting with the President of the United States." The second man said, "To me, success would mean meeting with the President in the Oval Office, having the hotline ring during our talk, and watching the President ignore it." The third person said, "To me, success would be meeting with the President in the Oval Office. The hotline rings, and he picks it up and says, 'This is for you.'" I don't know what your definition of success is, but Jesus said, "Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. But let me clearly state this morning that you have already been affirmed. The mantle of representation and public service is on your shoulders. Secondly, you are not only affirmed, but you're active. You've had an active session, and I know that pace is even going to accelerate between now and Thursday night. The eyes of millions of Georgians are on you, and we're all interested in what you do and the decisions that are made under this gold dome. We typically make our decisions based on our worldview. And today, we live in a world with some crazy views and ideologies. One is relativism. Relativism is the philosophy that truth is always changing, that there are no absolutes. Willie Nelson, the country and western singer, before he got in trouble with the IRS, owned his own golf course. One day someone asked him about par. Willie said, "Well, par is anything you want it to be." He said, "Do you see that hole over there?" He said, "That's a par 47. Yesterday I birdied it." In America, 67% of the adults, however, agree that there is no absolute truth. And much worse is the fact that 52% of professing Christians think that truth is relative. This nation was founded upon the principles of God's Word, and God's Word does not change. In Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 8, the Bible says, "The grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever." Another philosophy today is subjectivism. Subjectivism is the philosophy which suggests that something may be true for you, but it may not necessarily be true for me. Some time ago, the U.S. News and World Report had an article entitled "A Land of Liars." And in that book, this statement was made. It says, "America is a nation of individualized moral menus." Now, it's all a part of the humanistic philosophy that puts man at the center of the universe, and man, not God, becomes the authority for all things. In the pastoral ministry as well as in public service, we must make absolutely sure that we're operating in the best interest of others and not ourselves. I heard about this woman in Alberta, Canada, who stopped the attack of a grizzly bear with a 25 caliber pistol. It's the story of one woman's self-control and marksmanship with a little 25 caliber against a fierce predator. She reported, "While out hiking in Alberta, Canada with my boyfriend, we were surprised by a huge grizzly bear charging at us out of nowhere. She must have been protecting her cubs because she was amazingly aggressive." She recalled, "If I had not had my little 25 caliber Beretta with me, I would not be here today. Just one shot to my boyfriend's knee was all it took." "The bear got him, and I was able to escape by just walking away. It's one of the best pistols in my collection." I tell you that story because that's too much subjectivism. It's too much of a self-serving attitude. And then, of course, there's socialism. This is a great threat to America, not only economically and politically, but also spiritually. Jim DeMint, the former senator from South Carolina, in his book, Saving Freedom, wrote, "On the cultural front, the socialization of values has turned right and wrong upside down. Isaiah in his day said, 'Woe to them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter.'" Billy Graham said years ago, and it's still true today, that right is right if nobody is right, and wrong is wrong if everybody's wrong. The average age of the world's greatest civilizations has been 200 years. And these nations have progressed through a 9-stage sequence, from bondage to spiritual faith, from spiritual faith to great courage, from courage to liberty, from liberty to abundance, from abundance to selfishness, from selfishness to complacency, from complacency to apathy, from apathy to dependence, and from dependency back again to bondage. Many believe that we're at the seventh stage, apathy. A nation of apathetic and complacent spectators sit in front of their television sets today and watch their world explode in between commercial breaks. Apathy. And apathy is the glove into which evil slips its eager hand. We've all fallen victims of this almost inevitable decline. And I'm not here today to play the blame game. The church probably is more to blame than anyone else. But together, we must endeavor to rectify the situation with our prayers and with our actions. Let's make decisions based on absolute truth, not on the philosophies of relativism, subjectivism, and socialism, but on those cherished principles upon which our state and nation were founded. It is a time for prayer, and it is a time for action. Make your decisions, and make your decisions count. You're affirmed, you're active, and finally, you're accountable. In fact, we're all accountable. Remember our verse, "For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required." One Sunday morning, a police officer in a small town was parked at the curb when he saw a car swerving all over the road. Taking off in hot pursuit, he pulled the driver over and recognized him as an alcoholic named Frank. The policeman said, "Frank, you're driving all over the place." Frank said, "I'm just trying to get to church, man." Noticing a bottle on the seat next to Frank, the cop said, "What's that on your seat, Frank?" Frank said, "Well, it's just water." The police officer said, "Well, give it to me." He took a whiff and said, "That's not water, that's wine." Frank just looked up into heaven and said, "Wow, he did it again." But when accountability comes, we will have no excuses. When we stand before our Maker, our accountability will be serious. Daniel Webster said, "My greatest thought is my accountability to God." Grantland Rice, the great sports writer of yesteryear, said it very well. "When the one great scorer comes to write against your name, he marks not that you won or lost, but how you played the game." We must remember that it is better to lose in a cause that is just than to win in a cause that is unjust. Let honesty, integrity, and accountability forever be the values that are the hallmark of this great house and this great government. Would you please join with me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this new day. And we recognize that your mercies are new every single morning and that your faithfulness is great. We thank you for our state and for this great nation and for the freedoms that we enjoy as a people called Americans. We thank you, Father, for this legislative body, for Speaker Ralston, and for those who serve with him. I pray that you'd give them strength for each day and wisdom for each decision. Give them the courage of their convictions. Help them to stand tall for you. And we pray, Father, that you would bless our state and our nation, those who serve us in places of responsibility, from the president of this great country to those who serve our cities and our counties. Give them grace and courage, and help us all to love you and remember that you are our creator, our sustainer, and our savior through Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray, amen. Please join me now as we pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Well, you were, that was wonderful.
Well, I appreciate it. My joy to be with you today. Hope you have a good day and today and Thursday.
Doorkeepers will unlock the doors. Chair recognizes Chairman Sims, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Your Committee on Information and Audits has read the journal of the previous legislative day and found it to be correct.
Chairman Sims, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits, reports that the journal of the previous legislative day has been read and found to be correct. Is there any objection to the confirmation of the journal? The chair hears none and the journal is confirmed. The clerk will read the resolution establishing the order of business for the day.
Mr. O'Neill, the 146 moves the following be established as the order of business during the first part of the period, unanimous consents. Introduction of bills and resolutions, first reading reference to bills and resolutions, second reading of bills and resolutions, reports to the standing committees, third reading and passage, uncontested local bills, morning orders, rules, calendar, privilege resolutions, through the resolution establishing the order of business for this legislative day.
Is there any objection to the adoption of the resolution establishing the order of business for the day? The chair hears none and the resolution is adopted. First reading of bills and resolutions, the clerk will read.
House Bill 4, Representative Guy Singer, the 48th, the bill amending Title Act, amending Title 50, provide for parimutuel wagering.
Regulated industries.
House Bill 664 by Representative Gassaway, the 28th, bill amending Title Act, new charter, City of Avalon.
Intergovernmental coordination.
House Bill 665 by Representative Oliver, the 82nd, bill amending Title Act, incorporating new municipality in DeKalb County.
Governmental affairs.
House Bill 666, Representative Caldwell, 131st, bill being entitled Act, create new Board of Commissioners, Pike County.
Intergovernmental coordination.
House Bill 667, Representative Fleming, 121st, bill being entitled Act, amendment Title 16, relating to carrying possession firearms.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 668, Representative Fleming, 121st, bill being entitled Act, amendment Title 17, relating to conduct, argument of counsel.
Judiciary.
House Bill 669, Representative Oliver, the 82nd, a bill being entitled Act, amendment Title 20, relating to local boards of education.
Education.
House Bill 670, Representative Fleming, 121st, a bill relating to registration of businesses using trade.
Judiciary.
House Bill 671 by Representative Rice, the 95th, a bill being entitled Act, relating to general provisions, pretrial proceedings.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 672, Representative Rice, 95th, a bill being entitled Act relating to exemptions, sales, and use tax.
Ways and means.
House Bill 673, Representative Dukes, 154th, a bill being entitled Act amending Title 48 relating to exemptions, ad valorem taxation.
Ways and means.
House Bill 674, Representative Welch, 110th, a bill being entitled Act relating to appointment, assistant district attorneys.
Juvenile justice.
House Bill 675 by Representative Guy Singer, the 48th, bill being entitled Amendment Title 46 relating to general provisions regarding public utilities.
Judiciary.
House Resolution 1 by Representative Guy Singer, the 48th, proposing amendment to the Constitution to provide for parimutuel wagering.
Regulated industries.
House Resolution 868 by Representative Drunen, the 85th, resolution creating a House Study Committee on Municipalities.
Governmental Affairs.
House Resolution 869, Representative Dempsey, 13th, the resolution recognizing the problem undertreated chronic pain, requesting state agencies to address the situation.
Health and Human Services.
House Resolution 870 by Representative Sims, 123rd, resolution urging the Capital Arts Standards Commission arrange replacement, suitable portrait, former Speaker Pro Tem Jack Connell.
State properties.
Through the first reader.
Second reading of bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
HB 656 by Representative Atwood of the 179th, a bill relating to general provisions relative to torts. HB 657 by Representative Kidd of the 145th, a bill relating to generation distribution of electricity. HB 658 by Representative Pack of the 108th, a bill relating to revenue and taxation. HB 659 by Representative Pack of the 108th, a bill relating to conflicts of interest by public officers and employees. HB 660 by Representative Pack of the 108th, the bill relating to general provisions regarding ad valorem taxation of property. HB 661 by Representative Bentley of the 139th, a bill to create a board of elections and registration for Taylor County, provide for its powers and duties. HB 662 by Representative Chokas of the 138th, a bill relating to torts. HB 663 by Representative Henson of the 86th, a bill relating to classification as superspeeder, fees, and funding for trauma care system. H.R. 844 by Representative Dawkins-Hagler of the 91st, resolution requesting the United States Congress to allocate funding for the Dobbins Air Force Air Reserve Base Commissary and extend the operation of the Fort McPherson Commissary. H.R. 845 by Representative Dawkins-Hagler of the 91st, resolution requesting the United States Congress promote and strengthen mutually beneficial security ties with home-based combatant commands as a method to reduce the overall cost of defense spending. H.R. 846 by Representative Drenner of the 85th, resolution requesting that the Commissioner of Insurance require insurers to disclose climate-related risks. Senate Bill 254 by Senator Harper of the 7th, the bill related to create a Board of Elections and Registration for Urban County, provide duties and powers. Senate Bill 256 by Senator Jackson of the 2nd, bill to amend an act making provisions for Magistrate Court of Chatham County, abolishing Municipal Court of Savannah. Senate Bill 257 by Senator Mullis of the 53rd, bill to amend an act to provide a new charter for the town of Tryon. Senate Bill 258 by Senator Mullis of the 53rd, bill to amend an act to provide a new charter for the town of Tryon. Senate Bill 259 by Senator Mullis of the 53rd, bill to amend an act providing a new charter for the city of Fort Oglethorpe. Through second readers.
Reports of standing committees. The clerk will read.
Representative England, 116th, Chairman of Committee on Appropriations, submitted the following report, Mr. Speaker. Committee on Appropriations has had on consideration the following resolution. The Senate struck me report the same back to the House following recommendation. Senate Resolution 378, do pass by committee substitute. Speaker submitted, Representative England Chair, Representative Sims, 169, Chairman of Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, submit the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination has consideration following bill of the House and bills of the Senate. Struck me report the same back to the House following recommendation. House Bill 655 do pass. Senate Bill 250 do pass. Senate Bill 253 do pass by substitute. Speaker submitted, Representative Sims Chair, through the committee reports. I get it out as quick as I can.
We're about to go on to the local calendar. We're going on to the local calendar. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills. If there is no objection, we will vote on the local calendar as a whole with a recorded vote. Hearing none, it is so ordered. The clerk will read the local calendar.
House Bill 655, Representative Nimmer, 178, Brantley County. Senate Bill 250 by Senator Jackson, 2nd, Chatham County. Senate Bill 253 by substitute by Senator Ginn, 47th, Madison County. These local bills have been before the House Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination Committee recommends bills do pass or do pass by substitute. Bills are being read today for the third time.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered on the local calendar? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bills? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the bills on the local calendar now pass? All those in favor of passage of the bills will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no. And the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of the bills on the local calendar. The ayes are 156, the nays are zero. These bills, having received the requisite constitutional majority, are therefore passed. All right, we're going on to morning orders. Chair is going to ask all members in the chamber to clear the aisles, take your seats, and cease conversation. Take your important meetings out to the ante rooms or the hallways, or you can go outside where it's nice and cool. And that might shorten some of the meetings. We're going on to morning orders. The chair recognizes the Minority Caucus Whip, Representative Hughley, for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, it's my pleasure today to recognize a special group of ladies who are visiting with us at the Capitol this morning. Today is Lynx Day at the Capitol, and the Lynx Incorporated is a group of over 12,000 women all across the country who have dedicated themselves to friendship and service. And today, along with Lynx members all across our nation who are visiting capitals all across the nation, they're here in Georgia, and we'd like to ask them to stand at this time. From all over Georgia, the Lynx Incorporated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes representatives, the minority leader of the House, Representative Abrams, Representative Mayo, and Representative Flood for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, it is our pleasure to recognize a very special guest this morning, and I want to ask that you join us in welcoming our newly appointed DOT board member, Ms. Stacy Key. Stacy is going to be serving the 5th Congressional District as DOT board member. And she's brought with us the Georgia Minority Supplier Development Council, the organization of which she is president. The GMSDC is the state's leading advocacy organization for small business development and supplier diversity, made up of over 700 small businesses who employ 85,000 plus employees with revenues of over $29 billion, as well as nearly 200 local major corporations. Established in 1976, GMSDC is headquartered in Atlanta and certifies, develops, and connects ethnic minority businesses with corporate and government partners. GMSDC is one of the largest councils of a 37 council affiliate network nationwide. GMSDC assists minority businesses in achieving a level of competency and capacity that enables them to compete as viable suppliers. GMSDC would like to encourage the state to reduce the disparities in the awarding of state contracts, recognize the value of increasing diversity, access, and opportunities for qualified and capable minority suppliers. Please join me in welcoming GMSDC for their day at the Capitol. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representatives Taylor and Riley for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, we have some very special guests here from Ukraine this morning. This delegation has come over several times. Previously, we've had legislators. This group are law professors and members of the judiciary, and I'd like to just have them stand and be recognized and receive a nice Georgia welcome from everybody here. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Alicia Thomas Morgan for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm also joined by members of the Cobb delegation, so if anyone else would like to join us. I am very excited today to honor Ms. Melinda Ashcraft, who is the president of Six Flags Park. Melinda grew up in Cobb County, and she's a graduate of Pebblebrook High School. And if you could believe this, she began her career as a ride operator the year that the park opened. And she rose through the rank and, of course, became president in 2004. And so under her leadership, Six Flags has been a true corporate partner in Cobb County, whether it's her serving on our redevelopment authority, her park manager, Jason Coleman serving on our CAUSE, which is a United Way project. They have truly been corporate partners and corporate citizens in Cobb. And so today, we want to honor Melinda Ashcraft. After 45 years of service, she is retiring from Six Flags Park. Melinda, would you please stand so that we can recognize you? We thank you for all of your service, and we congratulate you. Thank you again. Congratulations. Thank you, everybody.
Chair recognizes Representative Ben Watson for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You know, Georgia has a lot to be proud of. Excuse me. But the thing that we should not be proud of is that Georgia has the second highest rate of childhood obesity in the nation. Obviously, this is a serious public health issue. It's created a significant economic and human capital crisis on our state. Obesity costs Georgians more than $2.4 billion annually in direct medical cost and lost productivity. Obesity-related hospitalizations of children in Georgia aged 2 through 19 has increased 338% over an 11-year period. Personally, the physicians in my practice, the pediatricians, are now treating teenagers with diabetes mellitus type 2, and it is a significant personal issue relating to our practice. Reversing this trend will require a multidisciplinary approach, and the future of Georgia is tied to the health of our children and their ability to grow into productive citizens. So I wanted to thank Governor Deal, the Department of Public Health, Children's Health Care of Atlanta, the Georgia Food Industry Association, and other agencies and stakeholders for their leadership on this issue. Tomorrow, there's a resolution proclaiming United Against Childhood Obesity Day here in the Capitol. And I wanted to especially thank the Voices for Georgia's Children for organizing United Against Childhood Obesity Day. And I think we have a few of those in the gallery today. If they would stand, please. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Representative Sheila Jones for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. Human trafficking is a hidden crime. And on March the 18th, here at the state capitol, the campaign against sex trafficking in Georgia kicked off its public awareness campaign to take a stand against criminals who purchase sex from children. And they adopted the slogan, Georgia is not buying it. I'd like to urge each member to log on to the website and take the pledge that is listed there. The website is www.notbuyingit.org. And once you take the pledge, it is asking you to promote awareness about sex trafficking, human trafficking. I'd like to ask that Travis show the clip at this time.
It's more real than you know.
It's happening all around us, and Georgia is no exception.
The youngest, most trusting members of our state
are falling victim to sexual exploitation and trafficking.
It's time that criminals who purchase sex from children know that the secret is out.
And Georgia's not going to stand for it.
It just takes ordinary people being informed,
standing up,
and making a statement.
So when you tell me you didn't know,
we're not buying it.
Georgia's not buying it. For more information on how you can make a difference, go to ganotbuying.org.
I'd like to say that House Bill 141 that was introduced, sponsored by Representative Lindsey, and the co-sponsors on that bill, Representative Thomas Kaiser and myself, I'm glad to be a co-sponsor on that. And start effective September the 15th, certain businesses will be required to post notices in their establishment that will help victims of sex trafficking and human trafficking to seek help. And I ask that you especially log on to the website, click it, and make sure that you help put an end to the commercial sexual exploitation of children. And thank you, Representative Lindsey, for this much needed legislation.
Chair recognizes Representative Kidd for a morning order.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll beg your time for just a brief moment about something that each one of your constituents are interested in, something that we're interested in, and something that affects every town and community in the state. I introduced this little bill, House Bill 650, the other day, and it's still up there. And what it does is it tries to recognize the fact that for the first time in the history of the country, United States is not the number one manufacturer of goods. For the first time in history, China is the number one producer of goods in the United States, in the country. United States is number two. Walmart was founded, obviously, on Made in America. And now you can't find anything in Walmart made in America. And I think we need to set the example to our constituents and so forth to be conscious of what we purchase ourselves and what our schools purchase and so forth. I brought with me some of the stuff that our tax dollars are going to the schools, and the schools are buying that's made in China, and so forth. We can go on and on, all the different types of alligators and knickknacks and so forth that the schools are giving out that's made in China. Yes, it might cost a little bit more to buy something made in the United States, but through the factoring system, that money turns over 7 times back into the communities. If it goes to China, it stays in China. Even the campaign literature that we use, if we need to be conscious of it, even what I bought, nice little knickknack, cost me $1 that I gave out when I was running for office, but it was made in China, so I haven't reordered them. I think we need to be conscious of the fact. I'm not the smartest guy in the world by any means. And the legislation I introduced really hopes to spur some thought processes, because what it says is that anything made in Georgia wouldn't be taxed. Anything made in the United States would be 4.5% taxed. Anything made outside the United States would have a tax of 12%. It might not work, I don't expect it to pass, but I hope it will generate some thought processes from you folks out there who are smarter than I, so we can reverse this trend, let corporations know that we want them here and we'll do what it takes for them to come here. And we want things made in Georgia and we want things made in the United States. If any of you want to sign on to the legislation, you're more than welcome. House Bill 650. And let's set the example back home and buy stuff that's made at home and made in the United States, not in China. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Abel Mabel Thomas for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and members of this august body. Today, I would like to inform you of an organization called Heal the Atmosphere Association. It was founded in 1978 with a motto of Every Day is Earth Day. It has been stated that we are surrounded by forces of gravity, electromagnetic fields, light waves, sound waves, and atmospheric pressure. Even though these rhythms are most usual, they are often overlooked. Modern psychology speaks of these rhythms and the influences they have on the body and the mind. Misuse of technology has disturbed these cycles of nature. Noise pollution, chemical leaks into the atmosphere have caused a disturbance in the ozone shield of the planet. Today, we witness many extremes in the weather as all nature seems to run rampant. It's become common for people to say they've never seen things as they are today. Heal the Atmosphere Association has a process that they believe will help reset the energy cycle. The Heal the Atmosphere Association supports scientific investigation, public awareness of homotherapy, a process of purification and fumigation related to the science of medicine, bacteriology, and bioenergy. This is a simple process based on the gear system nature corresponding to the rhythms of sunrise and sunset. Experiments conducted at the Agricultural University of Washington, D.C., the Baltimore Family Life Center, the Pharmaceutical Study Network in Germany, and Shante Village Institute of Tuskegee have shown a significant reduction of pollution at the performance of homotherapy. Witnessing the positive effects of these experiments, members of Heal the Atmosphere Association urge government and scientific community to use these technologies to further study homotherapy. I have the honor of having the founder of the Heal the Atmosphere Association here at the Capitol today at 12 in room 230, and he will be available to talk about some of the experiments and some of the ways that agriculture and homotherapy has helped in terms of purifying the environment. And so I'd like to put that information out to you and ask those that are available to come down at 12. They'll be there from 12 to about 2 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Representative Carson for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Most of you know that I'm a full-time employee for SunTrust, and they're looking forward to Sunny Day, so I actually do some work for SunTrust. Anyways, today we have with us in the gallery the SunTrust Not-for-Profit and Government Banking Group. This is a group that focuses on, obviously, not-for-profits, a lot of local government cities, some of your cities, some of your counties, county governments. They're here today to see the General Assembly in action, and obviously there's going to be a lot of action today and Thursday. Would you stand and welcome them, the SunTrust Group? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Kaiser for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wanted to say that I have a special guest here in the chamber today. I see a lot of ladies in blue, but the lady in the very back in the blue with the gray hair is my mother, who's also the mayor of Athens, Georgia. And hello. And I'll tell you why this mayor is here today. Today is the 8th annual Ride to the Capitol. So cyclists from all over the city and Roswell, Douglasville, Decatur, and Atlanta and beyond are riding to the Capitol today. So when you see a bunch of cyclists around the Capitol, be sure to talk to them. Many of them are, bikers, cyclists, not motorcycles, or bicyclists. So if you see some cyclists around the Capitol today, many of them will probably be your constituents. My son rides on a team called the Junior Flyers, and they are riding here today from Decatur. And Dr. Watson, you'll be happy to know this, their cause is childhood obesity. So they're riding for a good cause. And I actually, when I saw the snow flurries this morning, I wimped out and decided not to ride myself. So my son's riding for his grandmother and me today. So be sure to welcome your cyclists to the Capitol today. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The House will be in order. We are on morning orders. For this next morning order, I'd like for every member that is in the chamber to please take their seats. If you need to take care of business, then exit to the ante rooms. Please take your seats and cease conversation. Chair recognizes for a morning order, Chairman Penny Houston.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is a very, very special day for so many people that were in appropriations for the past few years. We'd like to welcome a special friend back to the House, Chase Jones. And we want to tell him how much we love him and how much the people in this House think about him and appreciate all the work he's done for this House and for the state. And Chase will be here today. And please stop by and say hello. And if you'd like your picture made with him, you can have it made in the ante room. We just feel like we've got a star here today, and we want to thank him for coming by and saying hello. And Chase, we love you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Made a lot of people happy, Chase, by being here today. Thank you. Chair recognizes Representative Tankersley to introduce the doctor of the day.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Even if you're not feeling well today, it's a great day because we have an awesome doctor in the House. Dr. Scott Boelke was sworn in as president of the Medical Association of Georgia in Savannah on October the 12th, 2012. Dr. Boelke cares for his patients at his family practice in Brooklyn, which is my hometown, and it's just 8 miles east of Statesboro, home of Georgia Southern University. He attended the University of Georgia on a baseball scholarship and graduated from the Medical College of Georgia in August of 1992. He conducted his residency with the Columbus Regional Healthcare System and served as an officer in the United States Air Force. Dr. Bolke also played baseball in the Atlanta Braves minor league system. In 2002, he became the first physician in his region to use electronic medical records. Probably the most important thing you need to know about Dr. Bolke is that his wife, Jennifer, is my campaign manager. She has been in the past, and she has helped me throughout my state representative endeavor. I want to say thank you to Dr. Bolke on behalf of the Georgia General Assembly for being our Doctor of the Day for two consecutive years and for being an effective advocate for maintaining the patient-physician relationship. We also commend him for his service as president of the Medical Association of Georgia during this past year. He's my personal doctor, and I'm thankful that he chose to practice in my rural little town of Brooklyn. Thank you, Dr. Bolke. We have a little resolution to give you. I think it's right. Oh, you got it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So, on behalf of Georgia General Assembly, thank you
very much.
Would you like to say a few words?
Yeah. Thank you very much, and I know y'all have a busy day, so I know you'll be for a long day. But I'll know when she's out of session. She'll be in my office here shortly, probably next week. So thank you very much.
We're moving on to the rules calendar. The clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 177.
Senate Bill 177 by Senator Ginn of the 47th, a bill being titled Act Amending Title 50 relating to the Department of Economic Development, so as change membership, Georgia Tourism Foundation. Bill has been for the House Committee on Economic Development and Tourism. Committee recommends that this bill do pass by way of a committee substitute. Bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chair Stevens to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House. Senate Bill 177 is a bill drafted, of course, carried by my counterpart in the Senate, Senator Ginn, and it retransforms the Tourism Foundation, which was created back in 2005. As a joint partnership between public and private sectors so that we could leverage some of the dollars for funding. Unfortunately, because of the budget cuts, the Tourism Foundation has not been active since 2007. In 2012, the current foundation voted to put itself on hiatus. So what this bill, the original bill created the foundation in 2005, was fashioned, made up of representatives of numerous state-related entities, which essentially are no longer in existence, the Georgia Music Hall of Fame, the Golf Hall of Fame, and others. Senate Bill 177 simply reconstitutes the Tourism Board to include 20 members, two of which will now be members of the General Assembly. Section 2 of the bill was added here in the House, and these provisions simply allow the Department of Economic Development to disperse these funds to local development authorities that the department may receive in a federal grant. Essentially, that's all the bill does. Madam Chairman, I'll answer any questions. If not, I'll ask for a favorable consideration of Senate Bill 177.
There are no questions. The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted?
One more.
Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of the bill. The yeas were 159, the nays were 1. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 218.
Senate Bill 218 by Senator Gooch, 51st. A bill of entitled 32, laying the dimensions, weight, vehicles, and loads so as to provide for qualifications for the issuance of an annual commercial wrecker emergency tow permit. Bill having been from the House Committee on Transportation Committee recommends bill do pass. Bill's being read today for its third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Roberts to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I bring the same bill that we have voted on twice already this year. And it's the emergency wrecker tow bill. Hopefully this time, I'm asking you one more time, if you vote for this bill, we won't see it back again this year. And I do apologize, but it got hung up in the Senate on the other side, and so we decided to move this one forward to try to be able to give them some relief so that they can clear our roadways in the event of an emergency from the standpoint of a wreck or a broken down 18-wheeler or big truck. Madam Speaker, if there's any questions, I'll be glad to answer them. If not, I yield the well and ask for your favorable consideration.
There are no questions.
Thank you.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of the bill. The yeas were 163, the nays were 0. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 145.
Senate Bill 145 by Senator Heath, 31st, bill of entitled Admin Code Section 48-5-7.4 relating to bona fide conservation use property so as to add farm weddings to the definition of agritourism. Bill has been with the House Committee on Ways and Means. Committee recommends bill passed by committee substitute. Bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Knight to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. This bill does two things and two things only. It allows for the use of property in the CUVA to be used for farm weddings if that property has been in the covenant for at least 1 year. Again, farm weddings. And secondly, it allows for the use of equestrian performance events if they're nonprofit. Again, if the property has been in the covenant for 1 year. These are incidental uses and in no way changes the conservation use of the property. With that, Madam Speaker, I'll ask for favorable consideration, and I'll also take questions if there are any.
There is a question.
All right.
The chair recognizes Representative Lindsay for a question.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Will the gentleman yield?
I will.
It is day 39. Some unusual bills come before us. Could you please define a farm wedding? Some of us want to make sure that we keep within the traditional view of what a marriage is.
I don't know if I want to answer that question to my majority whip. It's just a wedding out on a farm. That's all it is. Nothing more, nothing less. With that, Madam Speaker, I will ask for everyone's favorable consideration and yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 160, the nays were 1. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. The clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 62.
Senate Bill 62 by Senator Hill, 32nd. A bill being entitled Act being entitled 31 relating to care, protection of indigent and elderly patients so as to establish the federal and state-funded health care financing programs overdue committee. Bill has been for the House Committee on Health and Human Relations and Aging. Committee recommends the bill to pass by substitute. Bill is being read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Kirby to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I bring to you today House Bill 62. House Bill 62 is about us accepting our responsibility to the people of Georgia. This is saying that we are accountable to the people of Georgia and how we spend their money, whether it's coming from the state and also that money that comes back from the federal government. This bill creates the Federal and State Funded Healthcare Financing Programs Overview Committee. This committee would be made up of both members of the House and Senate, and they would be responsible for reviewing how that money is being spent by the board and the department to make sure we are spending the people's money wisely. And if there are no questions, Madam Speaker, I will yield the well.
There are no questions.
Thank you. I ask for your favorable consideration.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 126, the nays were 27. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 91.
Senate Bill 91 by Senator Harper the 7th. The bill will be entitled 2, relating to agriculture, so to repeal the Emerging Crops Fund Act. Bill hadn't been for the House Committee on Agriculture and Consumer Affairs. The committee recommends the bill do pass by way of a committee substitute. This bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman McCall to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Excuse me. Senate Bill 91, all it does originally was to delete the language it was in code about emerging crops. It's been in there since probably the early 70s. What we did in Ag Committee was set up a framework and use the emerging crops language to set up a mechanism to help fund new and beginning farmers through the Georgia Development Authority. The average age of Georgia farmers are my age, and I'm an old guy. For every three farmers in the United States that are over 65, there's only one that's under 35. So what this does is set up a mechanism that in Georgia, new and beginning farmers can go and acquire a loan for whatever they need it for agriculture purposes. Sometimes banks don't want to work with them when you don't have assets. And this is just another mechanism for us to keep the number one industry in the state of Georgia alive and well with young folks running it.
There are no questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 161, the nays were 1. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption, Senate Resolution 293.
Senate Resolution 293 by Senator Gooch, the 51st, a resolution honoring the life of Mr. Ralph A. Pierce, dedicating a road in his memory. This resolution has been before the House Committee on Transportation. The committee recommends the resolution pass by way of a committee substitute. Resolution is being read today for its third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Roberts to present the resolution.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the annual road naming, bridge naming, dedication update bill. What we basically done was we took ours and put it on the Senate bill when it comes over. There were a few that actually didn't make the deadline. Those were now incorporated into this as well. The Senate's going to do the same thing. They're going to add our road namings to their road namings to our bill as this over in the Senate as well. If you've got any questions, feel free to answer them. If you've got any, come by and see me at my desk. I'll show you what's in there. But if there's no questions, Madam Speaker, I ask for your favorable consideration.
There are no questions. The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which is favorable to the adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this resolution now be adopted? All in favor of the adoption of the resolution will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the adoption of the resolution, the yeas were 169. The nays were 1. The resolution, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore adopted. Clerk will read the captions to a group of privileged resolutions.
The resolution for Representative Taylor's 79th recognized commending the Wildlife Club. A resolution by Representative Smith, the 70th, recognized commending Dr. James E. Jim Kundal for his service to the state of Georgia. A resolution by Representative Sheldon, 104th, recognized commending Mr. Marvin Atherton for his outstanding public service. A resolution by Representative Evans, 42nd, congratulating the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers on the occasion of its 125th anniversary. Resolution by Representative Teasley of 37th, on the life and memory of Mr. Robert Detweiler. Resolution by Representative Dempsey of the 13th, commending Gray Taylor, Model High School 2013 Star Student. Resolution by Representative Dempsey of the 13th, commending Unity Christian School's 2013 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Dempsey, commending Unity Christian School's 2013 Star Student. A resolution by Representative Dempsey commending Armucci School's 2013 Star Teacher. A resolution by Representative Dempsey of 13th commending Darlington School's 2013 Star Teacher. A resolution by Representative Dempsey commending Mrs. Beth Bagby Smith and for other purposes. A resolution by Representative Dempsey recognizing Mr. Robert Skelton, recipient of 2013 Heart of the Community Award of Honor. A resolution by Representative Dempsey recognized commending Jim Bonnie Moore as the recipients of 2013 Heart of the Community Award of Honor. Resolution by Representative Dempsey of 13th recognized commending Dr. Robert Hortman, recipient 2013 Heart of the Community Award of Honor. Resolution by Representative Dempsey recognized commending Matt Davis. Resolution by Representative Dempsey honoring these Darlington School's 2013 Star Student. A resolution by Representative Dempsey recognizing commending Ann Culpepper. Resolution by Representative Dempsey, 13th, recognizing Coosa High School's 2013 Star Student. A resolution by Representative Dempsey, 13th, commending Pepperell High School's 2013 Star Teacher. A resolution by Representative Dempsey recognizing Model High School's 2013 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Dempsey commending Coosa High School's 2013 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Dempsey recognizing Rome High School's 2013 Star Student. Resolution by Representative Dempsey commending Rome High School's 2013 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Smyrie congratulating commending Tony Hodge. A resolution by Representative Smyrie recognized commending Mrs. Ingrid Saunders Jones on the occasion of her retirement. Resolution by Representative Roberts, 155th, recognizing March 26, 2013, Georgia Railroad Association Day at the State Capitol. Resolution by Representative Mitchell, 88th, honoring the life and work of Ms. Carolyn Miller. Resolution by Representative Williams, 119th, recognized commending University of Georgia Women's Swimming Diving Team Coach Jack Ball. Resolution by Representative Hardin, 148th. Congratulating Lizzie B. Punch Brown McAdoo on her 80th birthday. And the resolution by Representative Thomas 56 on life and memory of Mr. Robert Williams Jr. through the privileged resolutions.
Is there any objection to adopting the privileged resolutions? The chair hears none and the resolutions are adopted. If members would like to have page photographs before the break, now would be the appropriate time. This house will be in recess until 1:30.
Okay.